the information not real time, and the information is coarse-grained. Also, pooling will require the continuous work from the monitoring probe. When we do the sampling, it means that we might miss some important information, such as microbes in the network. So INT is the solution for this problem. INT is defined as a framework which allows collecting and reporting the network state from the data plane without the work from the control plane. So how INT work? Here we have a small topology with shop and destination. When we send the packets from the shop to destinations, the packets has a header and payload. However, when the packets pass through the first switch, the monitoring data of the first switch will be attached to the packets as M1 view here. The data can be any type of data such as switch ID, hop latency, ingress or egress port, etc. And the process happens same in the next switch, the second switch. You can see that we have empty field here. In the third switch, because this is the final switch, the INT process will restore the original packet and send to the destinations. Meanwhile, the monitoring data is charted and sent to the monitoring probe. So by working this way, IT provides many advantages. It's more real-time. It's not actually truly real-time, but it's more real-time than the traditional methods. It has a packet-level granularity because the data is attached to every packet in the network. And it does not require the continuous pooling from the monitoring probe. Also, INT provides a complete view of the network state in the flow path. The INT implementations require that INT to be implemented in the data plane. And for the inline speed, the data plane should be a hardware data plane such as FPGA or network processing unit or P4 supported hardware. And our decision is to choose P4. So what is P4? P4 is defined as a programming protocol independent packet processors. Actually, I don't like the word programming here much because P4 is more like a hardware description language like Verilog or VNDL, not a programming language, but anyway. So P4 allows the programmer to freely to program how the packets will be processed in the data plane. P4 applies the match action approach, which is like OpenFlow, but in OpenFlow, you can see that all the match action tables are already fixed in the OpenFlow specifications. However, with P4, you are free to program the mesh actions as you need. So P4 allows custom packet processing, custom packet formats, which is suitable for implementing INT. And in ONOS, P4 is already supported from ONOS version 1.6. In a subsystem called ONOS BMB, the words BMB2 switch, which is the virtual switch for P4 simulations. And from now, I will talk about the anti-mon, the anti-monitoring system in ONOS. In anti-mon, the anti-data is embedded as a TCP and UDP stream header. The packet format is presented in this figure. Because the anti requires a specific port to for the protocol detection, so we put the anti port here in the original place of TCP and UDP port. So we need to back up the original destination port here. The other fields of the packet structures is already defined in the specifications. The type of data can be monitored in the post-read information, which include switch ID, hop latency, ingress, egress, port ID, etc. And it's important to note that it is possible and it is very easy to add other type of data to the anti-packet format. It requires a very little change in the code. This figure shows the architectures of anti-mount. This below part is the anti-switch, which consists of the parser, a forward link, and an anti-process block. The parser is a very traditional block which passes the packet from the Ethernet layer to IP to TCP UDP and finally to the anti layer. The forward is in international block this and remove the anti data, anti header, and it will send the anti packet to the owners when the packet arrives to the final switch. This above is the anti-mount owners applications, and there are three important blocks. The first one is the anti-mount control, and this one will decide. We allow us to decide which flow to be monitored and which type of data to be monitored. This anti-mount collector and processor here will receive and process the anti-data into the meaningful data which can be used for other service or for display. All the information and control can be controller and viewer from the web interface. You can see here we have a file called switch.json. This is the compiler results from the P4 anti code. And at the very first time the anti mount started, this file is deployed into the BMV2 switch to turn this simulation switch to our anti mount switch. And we also have some Java interpreter here port our work to the P4 16 versions. So as other P4 program, the anti-mount is a collection of table with a match field and actions which do the anti-work. A very example of anti-work is if the packet sent to the final switch in the path, then we need to remove the anti-header and data before the packet is sent to the final destination, so the monitoring process is transparent from the end terminal, right? So this work will require the code from anti-mount and the anti-controller. So in the anti-mount P4 code, we have a table here called table anti-sync. And in this table, we have a field called ingress to egress.sync, which indicate if the packet is at the final switch or not, and the action is anti-sync. This action consists of several other actions, such as remove the anti-header, remove the anti-data, or restore the original length of the IP packet or UDP packet. And this table will sync flag is equal to 1, then we will do these actions. So this rule will be deployed from the anti-mount controller. So here is the code for doing these actions. Here we create a match field for ingress to egress.sync with the value 1. And with this value, we do this action anti-sync. And this match actions is applied to the table anti-sync. After doing these three steps, we have a flow rule, and then we just apply the flow rule to the anti-switch. Very simple, right? And this process is applied to every other actions, every other anti-work. In IT mode, we provide a control interface to control which flow to be monitored and which type of data to be monitored. The flow filter consists of short address, destination IP address, short path, and destination path. These short IP address and destination IP address, we support the wildcard mask. Also, multiple flow are allowed. We also provide a monitoring interface which display all the information that have been collected from the IoT. We have a table here which display all the information of every flow that have IoT parking. We also have a time sharing graph to show the real-time port latency of a specific switch. Yeah, so that's all about the anti-mod system. However, our current implementations has some problem. The first one is, as I said, that for every packet in the network, for each packet, we will have one IoT packet sent to the monitoring probe. So you can imagine that in a very high-speed network, the number of packets sent to the monitoring probe is very high, so the CPU cost is really high, and also there will be so many packets that have same information because the speed of the packet rate is too high. So the solution for this problem is we do some sort of offloading processing in the P4 code. We will remove the duplicated information or unnecessary information. So how we did that? We can compare two packets, and if the two packets had the same information, we will not send the second packet to the owners. And also for some type of data such as port latency, sometimes we only care about the we only care if the hop latency gets above a threshold, which indicates that we might have a microburst in the network. So we will only send the IoT packet to a node when we detected that the value exceeds the threshold. The second problem is in current implementations of IoT, there is no flow statistic. Only the per switch information is collected. So the solution is we will add a flow statistic field to the anti packet dispositions. The fields include the total number of packet, the average packet length, etc. And this information will be aggregated at the final switch. Yeah, I will summarize my talk. So in my presentations, I have talked about embedded network telemetry. This is a new method for real-time and fiber-rate network monitoring. I also present the Antimon, our IoT monitoring system implemented in ONOS. Antimon embed anti-data as TCP and UDP stream header. I also present about the anti-P4s and anti-ONOS applications, the code, the architectures, and the interface. And finally, I have present the current problem, which also will be my future work to tackle these problems. I will need to add the anti-data processing block in the P4 code. Also, I will need to add flow statistic into anti. And one more important work is to porting the current implementation to new ONOS subsystem. One funny thing I have found when I do these presentations is that my work based on the BMV2 subsystem which already deprecated in the newest version of ONOS So I will need to port it to the new subsystem in when the new P4 runtime is completed. But I believe that the architecture and the P4 codes will remain unchanged because the P4 16 and P4 14 codes are compatible. And this is the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening.
I cannot come with the microphone, so if you can come here, it's better.
Okay, I can speak louder. So, first of all, amazing work. It is an exciting before use case, and seeing this running a couple months is even more exciting. So, it seems like Monos is a collection.
Yes.
And
this is one program.
Personally, I think the solution to that problem would be to not to use Onos as a collector, but to send the telemetry data to another collector, or just specialized in a machine that does only that. So I was wondering, in order to implement this, right, to send telemetry data somewhere else, do you think which kind of modification would you need, and if you think that would be easy to implement? And the second question is, have you considered doing packet sampling for the what do you call the preprocessing problem?
No packet sampling. It's a preprocessing, which means that I can compare the packet if the information is duplicated in two packets, then we don't need to send the packet to the external connector or the send to Onos. Yeah.
Right. But in this case you're keeping memory.
It's a full memory in P4.
But in this case, you need perflow. Right?
So yeah.
I can tell you that hardware implementation of, I'm pretty sure that hardware implementation,
yes,
even software implementation, don't have that much state. So.
Yeah.
Unless you're like aggregating flows.
You know that these mesh action table, this is one special kind of the key value table store. So we can, one of my idea is to try to leverage that mesh action table as a stateful table for store and store as the modifications in P4 codes is simple because we just need to install a rule to change the destination IP address, but we need to modify the wait me a little bit. I haven't talked about one thing here. You can see there is a switch firmware here because in the VM Virtual Switch there is this part firmware, right? And we need to reprogram this firmware to encapsulate the packets because we might, if we send the UDP packet to the monitoring probe, then this will be not a reliable connection. So we might encapsulate this packet into a connection.
Okay, so thank you very much for your talk.